Thank you for tuning in.
We just want to thank you. Let's come back up here, please. Matthew, everybody back up here. We would like to just thank everyone for tuning in this morning. Thank you for coming and sharing your morning with us. We are so glad that you have decided this morning that you would like to be a part of a worship service at County Line Church of God of Prophecy. And we thank you from the depths of our hearts. We are excited of what God is doing and what God is going to do. We are really looking forward to that day when we get to be together again, to hug each other, to shake hands, to be in fellowship again. But right now, we just want to thank you for sharing this moment with us. And I'd like to just thank everybody for being here. I'd like to, first of all, thank Brother Jeff and Sherry for their service to the kingdom of heaven and videotaping and also recording live. We're very grateful for them. I'm very grateful, of course, for my wonderful wife. She has done a lot also behind the scenes. And my daughter, Alyssa, and for their praise and worship. My son, Nathan, as he works the sound equipment. My daughter, Madeline, for the one time she did decide that she was going to sing. And my son, Matthew, for cheering us on. And so we thank you for being a part of the service. And we're going to take a moment here in a second and pray. And we're very grateful once again because God is so good. And even in this season of life that we are all in together. You see, nobody is going through this season alone right now. The entire world is going through this season together. And so you're not alone. We are in this together. We are the body of Christ together. God is going to bring us through this together. And I know that the power of God is able. And here in just a few minutes, we're going to pray over the offering. And I would like to thank all those watching, those that have given faithfully, those that have given to the ministry for the kingdom of heaven. It is because of you that the gospel is being preached unto the ends of the earth. And my prayer is that there will be a 100-fold increase, a 100-fold blessing upon you and your household in Jesus' name. And it is because of you that the mission for the gospel of the kingdom of heaven goes forward. So at this time, I want to pray over the offering as we pray for a blessing over it. Father, we thank you so much for being our Jehovah Jireh, for being our provider. Father, we ask you to bless this offering. We ask you to bless and increase, Lord. I pray for a blessing, Father, on those that give, Lord. I pray for a 100-fold increase in Jesus' name. And Lord, we thank you that the gospel for the kingdom of heaven is being preached unto the ends of the earth. We pray for a blessing over this service. We pray for a move of your spirit today. We pray for souls to be saved today. We pray for lives to be touched today. We pray for those to come into the kingdom of heaven today, Lord. Let us be a witness, Father. Let the gospel be preached unto the ends of the earth. And Father, we lift up our voices to you as we get ready to worship you. I pray that we would worship you with our whole hearts. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to encourage you at home, where you're at right now, to just begin to enter in and to worship the Lord. I'm going to ask for the praise team to come forward at this time. And we're going to exalt the name of Jesus. He is worthy of praise. He is worthy of honor. You don't have anything else to thank him for. He woke you up this morning. He put your feet on solid ground this morning. He put a song in your heart this morning. And because of his faithfulness, because of the goodness of the Lord, we should be thankful we get to praise him today. So let us praise him together. Let us exalt the name that is above every other name. Let us praise the name of Jesus. There is no other name like the name of Jesus. So let us praise him today.
Lord, I thank you for this day. day. Lord, I thank you for your many blessings on our lives, Lord, and your protection.
Yes.
Lord, I just pray for over this praise and worship today, Lord, that your spirit would just flow in an awesome and mighty way, Lord. Lord, let us open up our hearts and minds to you, Jesus.
Yes.
Lord, we're nothing without you. With you, all things are possible. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
This song that we're going to be singing this morning, the first song is called Jesus, I Believe. It's been a while since we've sung the song. So if you don't know the words, just listen. But if you know the words, just stand and sing with us today.
Yes.
We are all uncertain times now. We don't know we've never known what tomorrow holds. Only God knows that. But with this coronavirus going around, we live by faith. And 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 says, "For we walk by faith and not by sight." But we just stand on God's promises, and we know that His words are true, and whatever the Bible says is true. And so we just have to hold on to His promises, and to know that God is with us and will protect us.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Lord, we thank you.
I want to see you, Jesus.
Bring
Praise the Lord. Let us go to the Lord in prayer and let's ask for His blessings on the remainder of this service. And let's ask the Lord to just bless the remainder of this time in a mighty way. Let us pray. Father, we come before You today, Lord. Grateful today, Lord. Thankful today, Lord. We thank You so much, Father, for all that You have done, all that You are doing. Lord, we give You praise. We give You glory. We give You honor. Father, I pray that You would give me a fresh anointing right now in the name of Jesus. Speak through me in a mighty way, Lord. I depend on You. I need Your help, Lord. Without You, I cannot do it. I pray You would speak to every heart that is watching right now in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that Your Spirit would move in a real way, Lord. And I ask You to bless this message in Jesus' mighty name. And all of God's children said, amen. Amen and amen. Glory to God Almighty. Hallelujah. The title of the message this morning is, but we must have faith in disappointments. We must be thankful in disappointments. We must give God praise in disappointments. And through all of this, we still can have peace in disappointments. That peace. We're going to come from the book of John chapter 11. This is the book of John chapter 11. It's the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead. Lazarus got sick. And after he got sick, his sisters Mary and Martha, they were trying to take care of their brother. They were trying their hardest to make him well again. I don't know exactly what all went on behind closed doors, but I am pretty sure that during this time of life, they were doing all they can do, and they were trying all that they can try to bring them back to life. They were trying to bring him back to life. And so what they were doing was, I don't know if they were getting a washcloth and wiping his sweaty head. I don't know if they were trying to cool his fever. All I know is Lazarus died. And his sisters were heartbroken. Jesus Christ saw them heartbroken. And Jesus Christ even was heartbroken. He was sad because he saw people suffering. The ones that were there comforting the family in this time, they were hurt. And so this is the only time in Scripture that I am aware of that it says that Jesus cried or Jesus wept. And so in John chapter 11, verse 21, it said, then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother would not have died. But Martha, she was disappointed that her brother was now dead. But Martha had faith that Jesus could do what he wanted to do to bring him back to life. Because in chapter 11, verse 22, Martha said, but I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. She said, I know whatever you ask God to do, it will be done. Martha had the I know faith in Christ our Lord. How many know we need to have the I know faith in Christ our Lord? We must have faith in disappointing times that we're living in now. We must be thankful in these times. We must give God praise in the times that we're living in. And through all of this, God will give you a peace that is past all understanding. And so we must have that peace. You know, we must also have the I know He's able, even in disappointments. We must have faith, like I've said, during this disappointing times. I used to work at a place called CP Films. I know many of you have heard me bring up times of working in this place in Philadelphia, Virginia. I knew that many times in workplaces, jobs that people get, whether it is a job to get in the door, what you know. It is what? It is who you know. Now, I remember getting on at that company, and I knew several people there, and they was talking for me. They were putting in a good word for me. And I didn't know anything about running a dollar, not anything about it. But I had somebody talking for me to get me in the door. I noticed a lot of times positions in the workforce, to be honest with you, promotions, when they happen, yes, it sometimes happens on what you know, but many of you would agree that is watching at home right now would agree it's not always what you know, but it's who you know to get you to that point, to the next level. Well, I received the job. Somebody did some good, sweet talking and got me in the door. And I got in and I had a job there for almost 13 and a half years before I left there to become a pastor. But the point I want to make right now, if you know Jesus Christ today, He is interceding on behalf right now to God the Father. You've got somebody talking for you. You've got somebody who knows who you are. Hallelujah. Amen. That ought to get you excited. Somebody ought to give God praise. And because of this, because you've got somebody talking for you, because you got somebody that knows your name, because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that ought to be enough to give you a peace that passes all understanding.
Amen.
And I know many of you, some of you that are watching or be watching later on, you may have lost your job. You may be on furlough right now. You may be going through a season of life where you don't know how in the world God is going to provide. When you look at the economy and you say, well, how is God going to make a way? You could say, Pastor, you don't know what I'm struggling with today. You don't know how difficult it is to pay my bills. Let me tell you something. The God we serve, He is our Jehovah Jireh, and He will provide and make a way. Hallelujah. I'll never forget a time ago, many of you have heard this, but I was laid off one time on a Friday. And I came home with the peace of God because of Jesus Christ living on the inside. I'll never forget, they called me back on a Monday or a Tuesday and they brought me back to work. They laid me off for a weekend and they paid me for Friday night that I didn't have to work. All I looked at, it was a vacation but an extra day's pay. I'm here to tell you, if you put God first, listen closely. If, look at your neighbor and say, if you put God first, He will make a way every single time. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll never let you down. He'll provide in the trial. He will make a way. And the seas, there is no other way. That's the God we serve.
Hallelujah. Amen.
We serve a mighty God. If He takes care of the birds in the air, if He takes care of the birds that don't have a place to lay their head, if He takes care of the birds and the cardinals and the blue jays and the big birds and the small birds, let me tell you something. He can take care of you and Jay Bird. Hallelujah. He can take care of everyone if you put God first. Hallelujah. And so you can have everything this world has to offer in materials. You can know the kings of the land. But if you don't know Jesus personally, you will miss the ultimate promotion that Jesus Christ wants to give you. You will miss a true peace that comes from the Holy Spirit. Philippians 4:7 says, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, should keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
God will give you a peace. You can't explain it. You don't understand it. You don't know how it comes, where it comes, but you know that He'll give you a peace if you seek the Lord in this season. And so, back to the book of John chapter 11 and 22, Martha, we read, she had that whatever faith. Even though she had a question and really didn't understand it all, she still had faith in God. You see, faith in God, it doesn't say you have to understand it all. Hey, listen, I don't even understand how to file my taxes. I know I don't understand it all. Hey, it's a lot of things you don't understand. You can't understand it all. But you don't supposed to know understand it all. You just take God at His Word, and you stand on the promises of God, and you receive it with faith, believing in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And so she knew, Martha knew, that Jesus had the power and the authority to change the scene. I know some of you need a change of scenery. I know some of you need a change of situations. I'm here to tell you, we serve a God who is able to change your situation right now in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Romans 8:34 said, who is he that condemneth? Yea, rather that is risen again. It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. You got somebody talking for you. You got somebody that knows your name. You got somebody that is going to God the Father on your behalf today as a child of God. That ought to get you excited this morning. That ought to give you a peace this morning to know that we got somebody talking for us. This isn't no ordinary person, but this is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that is talking for us. And just like somebody that's got a job on the inside, talking for you to get you on the inside, Jesus is with the Father of the universe. He's on the inside. He's in heaven right now, talking for us, interceding for us on our behalf in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And so because Christ is going to bat for us, we ought to give God thanks today. We ought to give God praise today. We ought to thank God today. Somebody give God praise the Lord. Somebody give God praise the Lord. You're saying, how do I give God praise? But Jason, we're living in unprecedented times. Let me tell you something. Even in the season that we're in, God is still good. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's still good. Hallelujah. But I want to make something clear. Jesus will not talk to the Father on our behalf if it's not God's will for us. Some have been praying for something for years that is not the will of the Father in heaven. Without studying God's Word, you can't and won't know God's will for your life.
Amen.
Too many believers today are praying and don't understand God's will simply because they don't know the Word of God. We must know the truth. We must study the truth. The other day, my son Nathan, he was in his bedroom. I was in the living room. And I had my eye on him from a distance. And I was looking at him. I had just peeled him an apple. And he took the apple to his room and he was eating that apple. And I looked and I seen him drop that apple on the floor. And he reached down and he picked that apple up. And he looked back down on the ground and he saw some apple crumbs laying on the floor. And instead of Nathan picking those crumbs up, I seen him, he tried one of them old school tricks where he took and he sweeped the crumbs under the dresser. I said, Nathan, pick them crumbs up, boy. The point I want to make today is we must stop sweeping the truth of God's Word under the rug. We must believe all of it, not part of it, but all of it. We must use it for the glory of God. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
And so when we know the Word of the Lord, we can go to Him with confidence that He hears us. Confidence that He hears us. And when we know the Scriptures, when we know God's truth, when we go to Him, we can come to Him with confidence, knowing that He hears us, knowing that He is interceding on behalf for us to the Father that is in heaven. Because Jesus will stand true to His promise when He goes to God the Father. And so we know even in the disappointments all around us today, we must still be thankful. We must still give God praise because He is worthy of all praise. God is still merciful in this season. During this virus, He has given people a time to repent. He has given people a time to repent. And because of His mercy, because of His grace, we have been also given this opportunity. I heard a testimony the other day. Somebody was sharing with me about 700 Club and how 700 Club, there was people calling in, and people all around the country are now coming to Jesus Christ through this season that we're in. And simply because of the trials and the tribulations, people are getting a chance to call on the Lord. Families are coming together. People are now getting a chance to come to Christ that may not necessarily have came to the Lord unless they have been through these trials that they have been in. That's why God is still good in this season. In His mercy and in His grace, people are receiving a second chance. How many are happy for the second chances today? Hallelujah. I'm so thankful for the second chances. You know, I was picturing the other day when I was studying this word, I can picture Jesus looking at God the Father when His children are praying, telling God the Father, "Father, send that answer to that prayer." They're praying again with faith. They're praying again with faith believing. They're praying again according to the word of God. Send the answer right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And I can picture that. I can see that. I can see God answering prayers in this drought that we're living in right now, in this season of unprecedented times, in the season of disappointments. God is still good. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And in the midst of this season, I've got a testimony I'd like to share. Some of you have heard part of it. None of you have heard. Maybe one or two have heard the entire testimony of this story and how God is making a way in the season of life that we're in. Many of you know that, and I made sure I called my cousin to make sure that it was okay to share this testimony, because I want to show you how real God is in, even in this season of life. Well, many of you know that my cousin took us all to an ACC tournament, and while we were there in the ACC tournament, many of you know the tournament got canceled. And as it was canceled because of this coronavirus, we went home and we got to see 2 days of basketball, and we didn't know if he was going to get his money back. We didn't know if what was going to happen with the money that he spent on these tickets. Well, he had found word that every penny of the money that he spent was going to be returned to him. So a day or two later, I received a text from my cousin, and he said, "Jason, what is your PayPal address?" I said, "My cousin, he's up to something. I don't know what cousin's up to, but he's up to something. I just know how he is." So I called him. He said, "Jason," he felt led by the Lord to give the money that was being returned to the building fund on the fellowship hall we are building. I said, "Well, cuz," I said, "let me know how much it is so I can know what to be looking for." He said, "It's $4,050. Praise God Almighty. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to give God praise for that. Anyways, he donated that to the fellowship hall. And immediately when he went home, he was laid off from his job. And they kept him at home. And the point I want to make is this. Not only did they keep him at home during this season of life, but his employer informed him that while he is sitting at home on the couch, that they wanted to pay him 100% of his wages to play basketball and sit on the couch with his hands placed behind his head. The point I want to make is this, and not only that, but if he didn't get called into work, they paid him double time for going in for the hour or two that he went. My God is a God of a hundredfold increase. Amen. My Jesus' name. And so when you do what God wants you to do, God makes a way in the good times and even in the bad times. Hallelujah. And so that's why we ought to thank God. Thank God in our thanks and praise of what He's done. What He's going to do, we will see the fulfillment of what Jesus wants to do. And so in verse 23, Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. He said, your brother will rise again. Jesus tells Martha that your brother is going to rise up. Verse 24, it says, Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection of the last day. She had the whatever faith, but still didn't understand completely what Jesus was about to do. Some of us don't understand completely what's going on, but Jesus is still working even when you don't understand it.
Amen.
I'm believing today that your dead marriage will rise again. I'm believing today that if you lost your job, God will still provide in this season of life. Yes. I believe that even if things are getting a little difficult around the house, that if you do what God has asked you to do, He will give you a better job. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Amen. And so we know that a lot of times a miracle will happen in ways you least expect it. Ways that you don't plan for. Faith in God is the key for anything to rise again. And it will happen now how you least expect it. I've seen God answer prayers and perform miracles in ways that we least expect it. You know, when you try to figure God out, you're going to get lost trying it, aren't you?
Amen.
You can't figure God out. God's going to do it His way.
Amen.
And so why is that? I honestly believe that God does it this way because when God answers, you can't take no credit at all for it. Because you never thought of it quite that way. I believe God answers prayers and performs miracles in seasons of drought and in ways that we don't understand how, simply because God wants to show us that it is not you, it is not me, it is not no individual that is doing it. It is the power of God and His power that answers and performs miracles in Jesus' name. And so we know in the midst of this virus, in the midst of all your disappointments, God is still in control. Don't trust yourself. Trust in God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Disappointment should drive us to our knees. Disappointment should force prayerless Christians into radical prayer. We're living in, of course, you know, the last days. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 and 2, it says, in the last days, perilous times will come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. If it ever was a time where we're living in an unthankful society, how many would agree it's right now?
Amen.
People are so unthankful in this season that we're in right now. Disappointments in this life should force unthankful Christians to be thankful once again.
Amen.
We have so much to be thankful for. We've got so much to give them praise for. I know the other day when the power went out, as I was carrying in water, the water bottles into the house, and when our power goes out in the country, for those in the city right now, y'all don't know what we deal with out here in the country. But I thank God for the country. I wouldn't have no other way, but in the country, when the power goes out, your well goes out. So you have no water. You have nothing to drink. And as I had to go back to the store to buy a few more cases of water bottles, and as I was coming in, I had a complaining attitude. I had a bad attitude. I had to ask the Lord to forgive me for my bad attitude. But sometimes when you go without water, sometimes you don't know what you miss until it's gone. How many would agree with me this morning? Sometimes you don't know how much you love somebody until they're gone. Sometimes you don't know what you miss until it's gone. But when the power came back on, boy, I was thankful again that the power was back on, that I had running water. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. And so today I believe the church, Christians around the world, must be thankful for what we do have. We must be thankful. If you were able to get up this morning, you ought to be thankful. If you were able to get up this morning and turn on the internet to watch this, you ought to be thankful. If the Lord has saved your soul, you ought to give Him praise today. We serve a God who is worthy of praise. He's worthy of glory and honor. Hallelujah. And so, we know your dreams don't have to die through disappointments. They can be resurrected by a God that never fails. Temporary disappointments can be the fulfillments of dreams coming true in Jesus' name. Disappointments can be the beginning of things that you would have never thought about coming to pass. We've got the internet here at this church. Through a disappointing season, right now, people are getting to tune in that may have never seen this message today. But because of a disappointing time, we are able to get the gospel out to the ends of the earth, all around the world. People today are receiving from all around the world, churches around the world. The gospel is being preached unto the ends of the earth. And so we look in verse 25. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Hallelujah. Yet shall he live. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those dreams, those plans that God has for you that have went dead or dormant are coming back to life in Jesus' name. Look at your neighbor and say, those dreams are coming back to life. Those dreams that God has given me are coming back to life in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Things that were dead before this virus hit are now coming back to life in Jesus' name. The peace of God in your life today is coming back to life in this season of disappointing time. I know some of you right now are watching, haven't had peace in quite some time. I know some of you here lately, you've just been a little discouraged because of the change of life. I know here lately some of you have really been struggling with being trapped inside your home. I know some of you are having trouble getting adjusted to this new way of life here in the last few weeks. But I'm here to tell you, my prayer and belief is that your peace that passeth all understanding, will be resurrected today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And so we know that Jesus said that He is the resurrection. Though you were dead, you shall live again, eternally in heaven. You shall live forever with Him in Jesus' mighty name. The other day I went to the grocery store, and many of you that have been going to the grocery store, they have got a limit on everything. And I see the limit on the eggs, and I've seen the limit on a lot of things, but for whatever reason, I missed the sign on the bread. And with a family my size, two loaves of bread just doesn't get it for long. And so I grabbed a third loaf. And I was at self-checkout in Walmart, and I was scanning my items, and you would have thought that I had committed a crime for checking out with three loaves of bread. Out of nowhere, this woman come over there, oh, sir, so no, you can't have the three loaves of bread. I said, ma'am, I'm so sorry, I didn't see the sign. And so I said, here you go. She took the other loaf of bread, and I took the two loaves that I had and went on, and but it was enough to get us by. But the point I want to make this morning is there is enough peace from the presence of the Lord. There is enough of the Spirit of God to comfort her through your praise, through your thankfulness, through your faith in God. You will have a peace that passeth all understanding. And there's no limit like the bread store. Hallelujah. He's got enough for all of you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And so I want to encourage you today, if you've never heard a man by the name of S.M. Lockridge, I want you to look him up on YouTube. He's got a little sermon on there about 3 minutes and 19 seconds. S.M. Lockridge. I wrote down a few things today of what he said. And S.M. Lockridge, in that message he preached, He said Jesus is the King of righteousness. He's the King of ages. He's the King of glory. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He's the sovereign King. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. That's the King we serve. King Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. To the Lamb of God. My question for you today is, do you know Him? Do you know Him? Do you know Him? Some of you today are listening, you may not know who the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords are or is. C.S. Lewis, one of the greatest Christian authors that we know today, at one time was an atheist. He didn't believe in God. He became very bitter from the death of his mother. He became very bitter in life, and he had discovered within his heart, he had thought that there was no such thing as a God. Well, it's the more he studied, the more he tried to discredit, the more that he tried to discredit God Almighty, the more he began to believe. And C.S. Lewis gave his heart to Jesus Christ, hallelujah, amen, to the Lamb of God, amen, hallelujah, to the Lamb of God. Maybe you're listening this morning and there's somebody that you love dearly that has left this world. Maybe they died at an age you didn't think they should have died, or maybe something happened that you didn't think was fair. Let me tell you, life is sometimes unfair. But the thing about this life is, if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you receive something that you don't deserve. And the thing about it, when the King of Kings and the King of Glory comes into your heart, He will give you a peace that passeth all understanding. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. And so if you're here this morning and you're struggling with the fact of somebody that you lost, a family member, a friend that may have died in a time or a season of life that you didn't think was fair, let me tell you something. God's got something for you today. Do you know Him? Amen. Do you know Him? And in verse 26, Jesus spoke and He said, "And whosoever liveth," who is that so? Whosoever, everybody listening today, everybody, "and whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this?" Whosoever liveth and believes in Christ will never die. That ought to give somebody peace today. That means you'll have eternal life with Jesus for all eternity. That ought to give you something to give God praise. Give God praise and glory.
Yes, yes, Lord.
And so there is a peace in believing. I know some are going stir crazy in this quarantine. I know some are getting cabin fever. Raise your hand at home if you're getting a little cabin fever. I can't see it. Raise it a little higher. But I want you to know, just when you think you ain't going nowhere, this earth right now, as I'm speaking, is traveling 67,000 miles per hour. We are really flying pretty fast right now. So when you think you're stuck, God's really allowing you to move. You're stuck to earth by gravity. That's the God we serve. We serve a God that made an earth to orbit the sun once a year. We orbit the earth, and when the year is up, somebody tell me how many miles we've traveled. 584 million miles a year. That's doing some traveling. I don't think that's being quarantined, is it? We are moving pretty fast. And the God, the amazing God of the universe, is mindful of us today. The God that has done all of this is thinking of you right now. What a mighty God we serve, hallelujah. Psalms 84 says, "What is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visitest him?" In verse 33 through 36, it talks about the troubling time. Here in this part where Jesus wept, I won't read it, you can read it later. We must remember in the troubling times, God is still a miracle worker. He still cares for you in the midst of pain, in the midst of tears, in the midst of hurts, in the midst of disappointments. He's still in control and God is still on the throne. Verse 39, I'm going to read it. Jesus said, "Take ye away the stone." Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, "Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he had been dead 4 days. We must ask the Lord to remove all stones of doubt in our life today. All fear and unbelief. I didn't even ask my wife and him to sing that song this morning. Help my unbelief. Help my unbelief. Let me tell you something. We must ask the Lord. Be real with God. Be for real with God. Tell the Lord, "Lord, I need help with my unbelief today. Help me to believe." This is why the body of Christ is so important. We need other believers surrounding us, praying for our stones to be removed. Did you see in that verse what happened? What did it say? Jesus said, "Take away the stone. Take away the stone." Lazarus needed some help removing that stone there. And there were some other believers there to remove that stone. Everybody needs somebody praying for them, encouraging them. Through your doubts today, God is able. Billy Graham, back in the 40s, he had already started preaching for Youth for Christ. And there was a man named Charles Templeton that began to try to influence Billy Graham different. He began to try to tell Billy Graham that the Word of God wasn't all truth. Believe it or not, Billy Graham actually started to doubt some. Billy Graham finally, probably known as the greatest evangelist to ever walk the earth, he even had doubts at a time in his life. He finally went in the woods and he bowed at this stump in the middle of the woods, and the Spirit of God began to speak to him. And he said, "I'm going to take this Word of God. I don't understand it all. I never will. But I'm going to take this Word of God as the inspired Word from the Spirit of the Lord, and I'm going to receive it." It was a matter of weeks later that the power of God began to pour out. He began to preach revival. Shortly after revival, he preached, 400 got saved. He then went on to California. It was a 3-week revival that was supposed to go on for 3 weeks, and the revival lasted 6 or 8 weeks, and numerous people gave their hearts to Christ. You see, the enemy of his soul and the enemy of your soul will try to put doubt in your minds to make you believe that all of this is a falsified, made-up story. But I'm here to tell you, by God is alive today. He's real today. He's able today to help you to believe. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
And so my mother, in the 60s, or early 70s, gave her heart to Jesus Christ through the ministry of Billy Graham. She was a young girl watching him on TV, and the Spirit of God began to move in my mother's heart, and my mother accepted Jesus. You see, the enemy tried to stop this plan. The enemy tried to stop me from becoming a pastor. You see, the devil knew Billy Graham preached, people were going to get saved. My mother got saved through his ministry. I got saved because my mother got saved and she prayed for me. And here we are today because somebody got down in a stump and said, "Yes, Lord, I believe." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. And so we know that in verse 39, Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Like a lot of Christians, Martha was a little hesitant to help roll the stone away. Sometimes Christians can be a little hesitant with helping others in their problems and walk with Jesus Christ. Some of us can be a little hesitant. Let's be real today. I don't need to sugarcoat anything today. Sometimes when people are struggling, we're afraid to reach in and help them spiritually. I'm not talking about physically at this time, although we should help physically. I'm talking about spiritually. I believe sometimes we think others stink too bad spiritually. Some of you are watching saying, "I'm not going to help them because they're too far gone." Sometimes I believe it's because we don't know what we're getting ourselves into. Let's be real, man. If I reach out to them and help them out and pray for them, man, I don't know how long this might last. Number three, I feel like sometimes we need help our own self. And we feel like we're not qualified to help others that are really struggling because we feel like we need help ourselves. But see, that's a trick of Satan himself to keep you from believing that you are not good enough to help somebody else in need. You see, when Jesus paid that price on Calvary, when he died on that old rugged cross, when he rose from the grave, and when you accepted that into your heart as a child of an almighty God, let me tell you something, that qualified you to help roll some stones away in other people's lives.
Amen.
And so we must remember, as the body of Christ, we are in this walk together. We must never forget that on our best day, look at your neighbor and say, on your best day, you are just a sinner saved by grace. Hallelujah. Lamentations 3, 22 and 23, it says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness.
Amen.
I love that song.
Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness. Well, I'd say it to you if I felt like I could get by with it. And so in verse 40, Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou would see the glory of God. Jesus said, if you will believe, you will see the glory of God. What is the glory of God? Somebody asked me, what is the glory of God, Pastor Jason? It is the expression of his excellence. The expression of his excellence. When God gives you peace, it's glory to God. When he performs a miracle, it's glory of God. It's the expression of his excellence. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When God does something, it is an expression of his excellence. Psalms chapter 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. And so in verse 41, I won't read it, but finally, some believers helped to remove the stone that stood in the way of the miracle. My question for you today, those that are listening, what stones are standing in the way of your miracle spiritually today? Is it lukewarmness? Is it complacency? What is that stone that is standing in the way? Is it unbelief? What is standing in the way today to keep you from moving forward today? In verse 41, Jesus thanked God the Father for hearing him and answering him before he could even see the answer. Jesus prayed, and then he thanked the Father for the answer in advance. Help me to know it was a troubling time, but Jesus still what? Thank God in advance.
Amen.
When we pray according to the will of God, we ought to thank the Lord. We ought to give God praise for his glorious name while we wait for him to send the answer. God sends answers in disappointing times that you might not pray for in a smooth season of your life.
Amen.
So when you pray according to the will of God, thank God that the answer is on the way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Too many times we pray and we wonder when it's coming, when we ought to be thanking God and giving him praise that it's on the way in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Jesus' name. And so in verse 20:41, look closely. Jesus spoke in the past tense. I thank you, Father, that you what? Heard me. That you heard me. Jesus had already been praying the last 4 days for Lazarus, I believe. Jesus had already been in intimate fellowship with his Father leading up to this point. I'm sure Jesus already received word from our Father in heaven that Lazarus would rise from the dead.
Amen.
So Jesus was simply doing what? Taking God at his word. It was only through intimate fellowship that Jesus knew his Father's will. Through God's word and intimate fellowship with our Father, we too can know the daily purpose for us. Faith is simply, listen, faith is simply taking the Word of God and believing that it's true.
Amen.
That's all faith is. Believing that the Word of God is true. Jesus didn't wait until Lazarus died to have intimate fellowship. Jesus didn't wait until 4 days after Lazarus died to have intimate fellowship. Too many believers, they wait until a disappointing time to call on Jesus. But how many know we must call on Him in the good times and call on Him in the bad times?
Yeah.
You're either running to God or you're running from God. After September the 11th happened in 01, many of you remember, those that weren't alive then, those that were young now and weren't alive during this season, remember the planes that went into the Twin Towers and this nation was devastated. After that took place, the churches were packed. There was more people in churches after that time than ever was a time in history, I believe. But slowly, since that 19-year-ago anniversary, people have got away from coming to the house of God when the doors were open and they were able to come. But my prayer is during this season of life, when the church doors open back up, it'll be something that will stick. It won't be a slow fade away from the house of the Lord. It'll be something that'll stick from now until the day we go to be with Jesus.
Hallelujah. Amen.
It'll be something that'll stick. My prayer is it won't be a temporary fix. It'll be a permanent fix. It will be a lifelong commitment to intimately following Jesus Christ. When believers don't intimately have a close relationship with Jesus, you're robbing yourself of joy and peace that's unspeakable and full of glory. I don't want to see you rob yourself of the peace that passeth all understanding. I don't want to see you rob yourself of the very thing that will carry you through this troubling time that we are in.
Amen.
The other day, my son Matthew and my dad, me, my father, and my children, we went out. We had to make a trip somewhere, and my kids, Matthew, and I don't know if he asked my dad for a dollar or my dad just gave him a dollar. Anyways, Matthew had his mind made up that we were going to stop by a store to get whatever it was he wanted. I don't know what kind of candy he had in mind. Well, we didn't get to stop where he wanted, and on the way home, he took that dollar bill and he gave it back to my dad. He said, "Here, Papa, here's your dollar bill back." He said, "I don't want to rob you." And so the point I want to make, don't rob yourself of the peace and the joy and the happiness that is unspeakable and full of glory. I promise you, you won't regret it. In verse 43, "And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come forth. Come forth.'" And if he didn't call Lazarus by name, every dead person would have come out of the grave on that day.
Amen.
Why? Because he's got the power and the authority to bring things back to life that once were dead. They will come back to life in Jesus' name. And so he said, "Lazarus, come forth. Come forth." For the glory of God, Jesus told Lazarus to come forth. Today, my prayer for you is that you're coming forth to a new peace that passeth all understanding. If you're at home right now and your mind's been troubled, if your heart's been heavy, if you've been burdened down, I say in the name of Jesus Christ, come forth to a peace that passeth all understanding. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So in verse 44, "And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto him, 'Loose him and let him go.' Lazarus got up and walked out of that grave. Jesus told those that were there to loose him and let him go." Once again, another good example of the body of Christ. We need each other to loose him and let him go. Has your faith, my question in closing, Caleb, if you could come and play a song. My question for you today is, has your faith in God went the wrong direction lately during your disappointments? Has your faith in God, has it took a tail in the wrong direction during your disappointments, during this season of life? My question for you is, when is the last time you thanked the Lord for what He has done for you?
Amen.
When is the last time you thanked God for what He has done? When is the last, number three, when is the last time you praised Him in a trial? When is the last time you praised Him in a trial? When is the last time, number four, when is the last time that you had true peace? True peace. True peace. True peace. Some of you today need peace. Through faith in God, through being thankful, through giving Him praise, you will see the promise of that peace, the promise of the Comforter, the promise of His Spirit. A lot of times we don't thank Him or don't praise Him because we just don't feel like it. Because we're in an earthly body. We're in a body that gets tired. We're in a body that gets weary. We're in a body that is disappointed. Amen. Some of you wonder how in the world do the angels stand around the throne all the time? Right now, how are the angels in heaven saying, "Holy, holy are you, Lord. Holy, 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 holy." How are they doing it, you may ask? Because they have a glorified body. This body right now, you might go 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes, and then you get tired.
Amen.
You get tired. Your body gets tired, or your mind starts wandering. But in heaven, we're going to have a glorified body.
Woo.
Just like the angels, hallelujah.
Amen.
Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Amen. Holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. And I believe those angels in heaven, God does something good all the time up earth. Something happens and they can't help but to bow down again. Holy, holy are you, Lord. And God does something else good again. Holy, holy are you, Lord. Some of your bodies are tired, but I know God is able to give you renewed strength in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You're at home right now and you're tired. You have no peace. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me right now. Father, you know the ones that are hurting today. You know the ones, oh God, that need peace today. You know the ones today, oh God, that are struggling. You know the ones today, Father, that haven't thanked you in quite some time because they just forgot to thank you, Lord. You know the ones, Lord, that haven't praised you lately simply because they just haven't thought about it. Been busy, maybe. Maybe they don't really know how to, God. Father, I pray for those that have lost faith during this season, that faith would rise up in Jesus' name. Faith cometh by hearing and hearing of the Word of God. So if you want your faith to be built strong, those listening, I pray that you would have a new gained thirst for the Word of God. That's how you're going to gain faith, no other way. The Bible says faith cometh by hearing and hearing of the Word of God. And so I pray right now for the discouraged. I pray for the depressed. I pray right now for those that are hurting and struggling and wondering when this is going to be released. I pray, God, that you would touch these people in their living rooms right where they're at right now. Holy Spirit, send peace all over the place. Those that are watching, those that are listening, those that are tuning in. Right now, Father, I pray for a touch of your Spirit upon them. And from this day forward, as you said, Lazarus, come forth. I pray that you would call the peace of God to come forth in their lives today. And we ask this and pray in Jesus' name. I want to thank you for tuning in. If you never gave your heart to Jesus, and you felt led to do that, or if you need prayer for anything, I want to ask you to give me a call, Pastor Jason Callahan. My number is 276-732-6557. I'm available to pray for you in this season. We can pray over the phone. And I know God wants to touch you and help you and encourage you and strengthen you. Don't give up. Don't give up on God. God hasn't given up on you.
Amen.
Thank you for tuning in. We love each and every one of you. We're praying for you. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. Goodbye.